Well, thank you very much for that introduction. Thank you very much for the invitation. This is my first trip to Georgia. I have been around Moscow, St. Petersburg, Istanbul, Baku, but not, so I have a sense of the area. And thank you for coming. I would like to start by the footnote of two things that, can you hear me well? Can you understand? No? What about that? What about that? Okay. So, 2 points, two footnotes to Maya. The modernity is the darker side of coloniality, the darker side of modernity. When I talk about we, I talk about a kind of collective, kind of small think tank that now is getting bigger, so it's not a general we, it's we who have been working in this project for 20, 25 years. So, when we say that coloniality is the darker side of modernity, we are not denying the contribution that Western modernity did to human civilization, let's say since the axial age, 7,000 or 8,000 years before Christ, was one of the civilization, and that has to be recognized. What we are concerned with is the aberration of modernity. And the aberration of modernity was and still is through neoliberalism. The project that started with Western Christianity to homogenize the world. At that point it was to homogenize the world according to Christian theology, Catholic or Protestant, the Orthodox. Christianity was not involved in this. To the market. There is a kind of history of coloniality that goes for the 500 years. So that is one of the 2 points I would like to mention in relation, but I forgot the second point. So I will go into the talk of today, and probably I will remember the second point. I didn't have my notebook. So I start with that map for a couple of reasons. Number one is to humble the West. Because you see, I come from here. You are more or less there. But in this circle, people living inside this circle are larger than people living outside of it. And when you have a capitalist economy, guess where things will move? And are moving, right? Like it or not, there is irreversible shift to the Eastern Hemisphere. So now I remember the second point that I want to make in relation to what Maya was saying. So modernity, beyond that aberration of modernity, consisted also, and we are seeing it today, here in the Middle East, in United States, in the European Union, is the polarization of everything. The extreme polarization, we can say, started with George W. Bush before the invasion of Iraq, when he was trying to convince the American people that the invasion was necessary. He said, "You are with me or with my enemy?" All of us who are decolonial said, "Sorry, Georgie, but I am neither with you nor with your enemy. So the decolonial thinking, the decolonial attitude is the linking from this kind of polarization that Western modernity kind of installed in many or all of us. Okay, so this is why I start with this map, to kind of think about where we are in relation to where the things are moving. And we are seeing it today very clearly in the trade war between United States and China. Okay, so those are kind of initial comment. I have, for my talk, I have four chapters, or four points. A decolonial historical narrative, which is the narrative of westernization of the planet, the westernization and the expansion of, at that time, Europe. Because Europe, Western Europe, kind of was the leader from 1500 to 1945. And 1945 on was United States taking the leadership. But that is what we call the West, the North Atlantic, now the EU and the US. So westernization and unipolarity is my first chapter. The second chapter is a decolonial conceptual narrative. So I kind of introduce some concept there in the historical narrative. And my third point is a decolonial conceptual apparatus, and we go very hard there into the colonial matrix of power. And then in the concluding remarks, I will use all that kind of historical narrative, conceptual apparatus, a conceptual narrative to understand what is going on today. Why we are in this kind of crisis that we see today, everything in the television, the newspaper, and the tweets and Facebook, etc. So let's go to the first chapter, a decolonial historical narrative. This may be at the beginning look a very strange, sound very strange to you, because it's about the Americas. But my point is that the world in which we are living today began to be configured in the 16th century in the Atlantic, when the Atlantic displaced the Mediterranean as a kind of the center of global economy. We will see that, I hope. So let's go with the first chapter, a decolonial historical narrative. Imagine the world before 1500. That is very, 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 very important. Before 1500, there were many what we call today civilization. Civilization that began to be formed around the planet, as I said before, since the Axial Age, according to German philosopher Karl Jaspers, when he kind of located. So you have it in China, you have it in Africa, you have it in this part of the world that we call now, I don't know, kind of Eastern Europe or Eurasia. In what is become America, the Aztec, the Incas. So by 15, there were many, 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 many civilizations. None of the civilizations were ideas. There were injustice, there were kind of inequalities. But there was one thing that is important to keep in mind. There was no one single civilization that began to impinge all over the earth. Right? So what we call today the West or Europe, at that time was a bunch of Western Christians that lost Jerusalem in the Crusade, and they were trying to figure out how to kind of expand Christianity. Columbus knew that, And when he landed in this land, he's trying to sell the project, and when he landed in Anahuacta, Huantinsuyo, that was the name of those places, so he took advantage of that. So the question is that Western civilization is the first civilization that impinged all over the others. And that is the aberration of modernity. So the, the splendor of Western civilization is to have created what it has created, like Egyptian, like Chinese, like Persian, like many others, right? And that is fine. But again, the aberration, the miseries of Western civilization, which is also synonymous with modernity. Modernity is the kind of one of the key words in the rhetoric of Western modernity, was to kind of expand all over the planet. And that is, we will talk at the end about that. So the second thing I want to say about Western civilization, I don't know how that will sound to you, is that there is no Western civilization until 1500. That is why I ask you to think the world before 1500. Why I'm saying that? Because Greece was not Western civilization at that time. The Greek were looking east to the Persian and south to the Egyptian. Rome, that came the second pillar of Western civilization, made us forget that Constantine was not in Rome, but was in Constantinople, which became Istanbul and then was eliminated from Western history. But also Western history eliminated Orthodox Christianity. Greece was Orthodox, Rome was Christian, right? So Western civilization began to construct a narrative of itself, and the concept of modernity became a crucial concept in that narrative. So modernity is not the historical moment, but is the narrative of those who locate themselves in the present of time and in the center of space. And that was Hegel, for example. Are you following me? Yeah? Okay. So, to summarize this point, before 1500, the planet was polycentric. There was no one center, many. And was non-capitalist. There was different kind of economy, of course, but capitalists, I don't want to elaborate much about that, but our thesis is that we call today capitalists is a kind of economy, but not just a kind of economy, a kind of attitude that began to be formed in the 16th century. So, before 1500, you have here you have three examples, but we can take more. The Chinese imagine their world in this kind of form of nested rectangles. The Aztec, this is more complicated, I won't go into detail, but these are the kind of the four direction of time and space, but also movement, because there is no concept of time or space without movement. And the Christian, by the Middle Ages, divided the planet according to the three sons of Noah. They gave Asia to Sem, Europe to Japheth, expansion, and Africa to the bad son of Noah. So the Africans were doomed already in the kind of the Christian imagination, right? And so when the slave trade comes, Now, the most interesting, already the image of the world according to the three sons of Noah was already established. Now, the trick is this. and then give you here, this is the map of Ali Idrisi, 1100, kind of Muslim. And this is very interesting because when you look at this, you see, what is that? What if I tell you that this is the Iberian Peninsula? This is Spain and Portugal. Why? Because the south is on top when you look at from what is today the Middle East. And if we go back, why we have Asia on top? Because there is where the sun rises. That is the Orient. So the north is later on when the invention of the magnetic compass. So you see how these things move, but they look kind of fixed. So that's one thing. And this what? So Ali Idrisi draw the map after Ptolemaeus, like this. But then if you kind of revert, you put the map upside down in relation to Ali Idrisi, I say, oh yeah, I recognize this is the Iberian Peninsula, this is the Mediterranean, this is Italy, this is Africa, we are in common terrain. No? Now, what happened by the mid-16th century is that the European, especially the Dutch, the Dutch map maker, Ortelius among them, this is not the Ortelius map, but what happened is that this is the kind of the image of the Earth that we began to have by the 16th century, not before. No one imagined visually the planet in this form. And not only that, but the planet was imagined in four continents, right? Asia, Africa, Europe, and America. How can you imagine that if you don't have this map in your mind? So what we are seeing there is the Christian map, the TO map, plus America, in a kind of more description according to the experience of navigation. But this has been implanted in our mind, and we think that the planet is like that, and was always like that. But if you take that to the child, and then, well, you have all this kind of navigation, etc. But I want to tell you now, if you took that map, the Ortelius map, to the Chinese will say, as they say to Matthew Ricci, who was a Jesuit, say, this is, this map is great, the intellectual of the Ming Dynasty will say, but polite as they are, the Chinese, they will say, why, if China is at the center of the world, as we saw in the rectangle, why you have it in the upper corner? So Matthew Ricci reflected, invited them back, and presented something of this map, like this map, which is the Pacific is on the center. And so then you have China more kind of located toward the center, right? This is so delicate that I move my finger and kind of jump. So there you have, I give you this kind of short story in cartography that is easy to assimilate and conceptual or economic statistics of inequality and gold and silver and cacao and tobacco moving from the Caribbean to London, etc. The cartography is an easy way to understand how an image of the world has been implanted in all of us. When people talk about coloniality of the mind, this is one example. Now, and we began to believe that this is true, that this is how the world is, and forget that this is a narrative. Cartography is a narrative, right? Yeah, we are okay? We are good? Okay. So, that map is still today, right? With more information around the map, but what you see is basically the world map when it's flat with the Atlantic in the center. But in the Pacific, in China, in Hong Kong, in Taiwan, this is the map they have with the Pacific in the center. So, now, with this short historical narrative that you can do it with economy, you can do it with politics, you can do it with art, and you can do it with religion, you can do it with whatever domain. Starting in the 16th century, how these things were formed, transformed, etc. Now, based on this narrative, starting from Aníbal Quijano, who is, he passed away a year ago, he was 90, Peruvian sociologist, he introduced the concept of coloniality. And that is the introduction of the concept of coloniality is a decolonial concept. It's not a sociological concept, it's not the economic concept. It's a concept that doesn't come from any discipline in particular. And there is a concept that did not emerge in Europe, but in the Third World. That was in 1990. Why didn't emerge in Europe that always is inventing new concepts? Because in Europe, coloniality is not seen. What Europe see is modernity. People who see coloniality are the people who have been colonized, or they kind of live in a history, a legacy of colonialism. So for European, modernity was the whole story. But from the Third World, what modernity, the darker side of modernity, is coloniality. Coloniality takes the name from colonialism, but they are not the same thing. Before I tell you what is the difference, let me make a correction here that I did it, but I think I did it late. It's westernization and unipolarity. Westernization and unipolarity from 1500 to 2000. From 1500 to 2000, Western colonialism, I am not talking here about Roman colonialism. I'm not talking here about the Chinese were colonial or imperial, or the Persian were. This, remember, was before 1500. And the kind of colonialism I am talking about is the kind of colonialism that was initiated with Spain and Portugal with the banner of Western Christian that was mainly Catholic, and then Luther came into the picture. So is that the westernization and unipolarity began to kind of be formed with the desire of Christianizing the planet. That was the theological plan. No? So westernization is the process of making an unipolar world order from 1500 to 2000.
And I tell you later on what happened after 2000.
But this is like the soap opera, you have to kind of wait for the next chapter. So there is a Western modernity is not homogeneous. There is a lot of conflict. There was a lot of conflict in politics, in economy, in science, in philosophy, in art. There is a diversity of a school, but they're all grounded in the same assumption, right? Among those concepts of conflict, of westernization, are the Glorious Revolution in England, the US independence, the French Revolution, the Russian Revolution. And I don't know if we agree or not, but the Russian Revolution is part of Western modernity. Liberalists and socialist communists were two child of the Enlightenment. That happened in Russia, that was not exactly appreciated as West by the Western, that's another story. But the project was a project, socialist communism is a Western modern project, right? Okay, so that is the movement of the unipolarity with the kind of division, the family feud between liberal capitalism and state communism until 1990, and I don't have to tell you, you know better than I that story. But I tell you, I bring that because to invite you to see the connection between what happened in the 15th century, what happened in England. It's inconceivable, the French and the Glorious Revolution before, without all the money that came from the Americas, especially the Caribbean, that really enriched the kind of the banks of the gold, silver, Venetian, London, Paris. Political economy was born in France and England in the 18th century. The physiocrat in France, Adam Smith, who was Scottish on the other hand, in the UK. But why was not political economy in Greece? Well, because they didn't need it. It's another story to be told there, right? Okay, so 1500, 2000, we are in a long process, a very complex process of making an unipolar world order. And then you see it, you saw it in Iraq. Iraq is perhaps, and Libya, perhaps is the last moment of this order, right? Where the United States and the European Union, England and then the European Union can just decide to kind of invade a sovereign country, even if we cannot talk about whatever, Gaddafi was bad and Saddam Hussein are bad. If you are living under the principle of state sovereignty, well, you don't have the right to just go and invade, right? But that was the last time, because couldn't happen in Syria, couldn't happen in Ukraine, it won't happen in Venezuela. So the unipolar world order is kind of closing down. But before that was a lot of time in the Security Council in which Russia and China stopped the intent of a unilateral decision by France, England, and the United States. So I am telling you, I am not for or against one or the other. I am telling you how I see the kind of the fabrication and why this kind of conflict. Right? Okay, let's move forward. Westernization, unipolarity, and the colonial matrix of power. Remember, we're in the conceptual narrative, right? So I introduced westernization, I introduced unipolarity, and now I introduce the colonial matrix of power. That may be, for many of you, may be strange because we don't use any kind of concept from European modernity or postmodernity or from US sociology or anthropology. We kind of have to fabricate our own concept because we have a different experience of history and the way of thinking about this issue. So then, let's start with a few concepts and the context in which those concepts emerged. The concept of coloniality, as I said, was introduced by Peruvian sociologist Aníbal Quijano in 1990. The end of the Cold War. That is very meaningful that this concept emerged precisely at that moment. Before that, in South America, there was the question of dependency theory and theology of liberation, etc. So, as I said before, coloniality doesn't equal colonialism from where it takes the name. Yeah? Colonialists refer to all Western colonialists since 1500. Spain, Portugal, Dutch, French, English, in lesser extent, Italy and Germany. These are settler colonialists. However, it's not a question of a settler only. It's the question of settling in the mind of the people. Together with political and economic expansion, it is an expansion of knowledge. And the expansion of knowledge has been achieved through six modern European languages. Italian, Spanish, and Portuguese, the Catholic South, the Renaissance, and then English, French, and German, the Enlightenment, until today that English kind of took over. So think about that. Think about the power of Western epistemology in science, in philosophy, in aesthetic, etc., dominated by these six languages. And you can think about yourself when you think about the relationship between Georgian and this European language. So Russian is a very powerful language spoken by many people. Mandarin is the language that has more speakers. Spanish and English are more or less the same, but English have the privilege of the hegemony. Spain lost the train of modernity in the 18th century, right? So coloniality is basically not just physical or economic control, it's the control of the mind to justify certain political and economic direction. So in decolonial thinking, the most important thing is knowledge. And that is one of our differences with Marxists. Marxists goes into capitalism and they see capitalism as a monster that kind of it has its own sphere. For us, what Marxists and liberals call capitalism is economic coloniality, but that is part of a larger picture that I will show in a few minutes. Okay. Coloniality is a decolonial concept. That is fundamental. It has to really understand that this, again, that it is not a concept that comes from any discipline. It's not an interdisciplinary concept. Is an undisciplinary concept. A concept that presupposes the discipline, but in the moment of emergence has to forget about the discipline. Why? Because the discipline disciplines you. It's telling you, you are disciplined, you are controlled, and you don't pay attention. So your professor, those of you who are graduate student, they will say the method, the discipline. So the question of undisciplinarity is fundamental because the concept of delinking that we will see in a minute come from that attitude. Okay, coloniality is a decolonial concept. Coloniality doesn't need colonialists to operate. China was never colonized. Japan was never colonized. Russia was never colonized, and leave aside the question of Russia, Soviet, but they didn't escape coloniality, right? So I think that Peter the Great is one example in which coloniality kind of made him believe that he had to kind of get the door through Europe in some, and he changed his name of Tsar, as you know, to call himself emperor. Huh? You see how the coloniality works at every level, right? So in the coloniality of the mind, Western Europe is Western Christian theology and secular liberal capitalism from 1500 to 1945, the kind of the whole apparatus that control your mind, our mind, and that decolonial thinking is trying to delink. From 1945 to 1990, the US leading Western coloniality. Right? The era of colonialism ends, but not coloniality. Coloniality without colonies. And how does United States manage that? Hollywood, technology, because all the technology, television, etc., the moment of financial coloniality, 800 military bases around the world that kind of nourish U.S. economy, right? Whether you have war or not, you have to make believe that we need a war in order to make the complex military industry work. Because you know, in fact, it's very, very complex. So in that sense, coloniality is not over. It is all over today, surrounding us. So I invite you to think, don't think that coloniality is over there, like God, any kind of God that you like to think. Coloniality is touching us. So you will understand coloniality when you discover how coloniality is touching you or is not touching you because you belong to the privileged sector of society, and that is not your fault because, I mean, you didn't decide where you were born. But it's your responsibility to become aware of your privilege, if you have privilege, and become aware of your unprivileged if you happen to be that part of the population that kind of never have privilege or lost privilege. And this is not uniform, there is a different way of... Okay, let's keep on going. So that, the conceptual narrative, some kind of basic concept that goes with historical narrative. Are you following me? Yeah? Okay. Now, this is the hardest part. If we go through this, then we go just land very kind of nicely. But this is the heart of the matter. Let me introduce you to the heart of the matter with a metaphor. You see, everybody here knows what psychoanalysis is. Huh? Whether you are a specialist or not, you are familiar, you have educated, you are familiar with Freud work, and you are familiar with Lacan work. What does a psychoanalyst do? But first of all, they invented the unconscious. So the unconscious is not something that exists. And then after Freud invented the unconscious, so you can find unconscious all over the places. You know? So the unconscious is a psychoanalytic concept. Yeah? The unconscious exists because psychoanalysis exists. And psychoanalysis exists because of coloniality, because of the unconscious, right? So what the psychoanalyst does is, there are three things. One is, what are they studying? They study the unconscious. From Freud to Lacan, they keep on kind of getting very complex and complex configuration of the unconscious. So the second thing that psychoanalysis does is the psychoanalytic cure. So when you have a problem, you go to a psychoanalyst, and they try to integrate. You have been disequilibrated because of the society of modernity, and it's not by chance the psychoanalysis was born in Austria, Germany, Austria, where kind of a powerful bourgeoisie, a disequilibrium of the individual. So Freud figure out that these people need something to solve the problem and invented psychoanalysis, right? So psychoanalysis is unimaginable to be invented in Zimbabwe or in Bolivia because we didn't need it. We have shaman. We don't need psychoanalysis, right? I mean, I'm serious here. So that is the psychoanalytic cure, is the second thing that the psychoanalysis, with all respect to Freud and Lacan, and all the people who follow them. And the third thing they do, when they are in a psychoanalytic seance, I mean, talking to the analyse, I have been working with psychoanalysts in Mexico and Argentina, so I have some kind of empirical investigation. What they do is they listen to that narrative, which is singular. I mean, there is no, each individual is an individual. Each person has his own, her own narrative. But the psychoanalyst is doing another thing too. Is listening through the narrative, listening to the unconscious. And knowing the unconscious, trying to understand the narrative. If you are not a psychoanalyst, you cannot do that. You need, let's say, a theory of the unconscious to be able to read a narrative in relation to what you call the unconscious. Okay. If the unconscious is a psychoanalytic concept, coloniality is a decolonial concept. That is the parallel I would like to make. So what does a decolonial thinker do? Well, we do two or three things. Number one, when we look at any kind of event, be it a piece of work, a map, the trade war between China and United States, the Russia Gate invented, I think, by the Democrats to knock down Trump. I am not for Trump, but it's obvious that the Russia Gate was invented by the. So when we look at this, we're trying to say how coloniality is working. How can I understand this event? Understanding coloniality, or what I show now, the colonial Mexican power. So like the psychoanalyst, we're listening to the story or the event, but trying to understand the colonial matter of power or coloniality. And knowing coloniality, we kind of, and if the analytic, the psychoanalysis, they work toward the psychoanalytic cure, we work toward healing the colonial wound. And for healing the colonial wound, you don't need a person who is expert in the colonial matrix of power. Healing the colonial wound is a collective, communal activities in conversation among people who began to realize what the colonial wound is. And the colonial wound is how you has been classified and made lesser human for whatever and multiple reasons. So the colonial wound is inflamed by making you feel that you are inferior. Yeah? That you have to become mother. You have to develop. You have to civilize. You have to have the next iPod or the next model of computer. Yeah? So that makes you feel that you are out of place, and that is the colonial wound. So regaining your humanity, regaining your confidence, regaining your dignity is the task of decolonial healing. And decolonial healing is done through knowledge, because it's through knowledge that we can rebuild ourselves and the link from the knowledge of modernity that make us feel inferior. When I say that, I am white, I am male, have a lot of privilege. But when I began to think about this, feel this, I began to realize that I was a third world person going to France to study semiotic. I was an immigrant in Argentina. So I didn't feel that it was Argentina. I was son of immigrant, Italian immigrant. So the awareness of being third world and immigrant was enough for me to kind of begin to think about this issue and began to feel how to understand how other people, if you are black, and if you are heterosexual, if you are homosexual and black, or if you are Muslim, so there is a different kind of way of dehumanization. But the third world was already a racial and racist concept, because what was the third world? Was the world that has to develop. Was the region of the planet that produced natural resources. And if those area of the world, third world, are lesser, so the people who inhabit those regions are lesser. So that is what I began to feel in South America, in Argentina, and then I discovered coloniality, and that explained what was going on. Okay, let me see. Let me go quickly about this. Coloniality is not a European concept, it's a decolonial third world concept. Modernity is a European concept. Europe needed that concept. Modernity, coloniality is a third world decolonial concept. And that is where coloniality is the darker side of Western modernity. So the consequence is that, of that narrative, is that there is no modernity without coloniality. And that is where we have westernization and unipolarity. And one more thing, modernity is not an ontological historical moment of universal history. That is what Hegel tried us to believe, and he makes me believe for a long time until I realized that that was a fictional narrative that to the convenience of German thinkers and German history, because after all, he was the philosopher of the bourgeoisie, the German bourgeoisie. Huh? So modernity for us is a set of narratives by actors and institutions managing the production and distribution and dissemination of knowledge. Right? So coloniality is a shorthand for coloniality of power and colonial matrix of power. And here we go into the heavy stuff, the colonial matrix of power. To give you the second approach to colonial matrix of power, we analyze the colonial matrix of power in these four spheres. Political coloniality, which is Western political theory from Plato to Carl Schmitt, to cut it short. So, for us, Western political theory is an object of study. There are like kind of natives, to now with an anthropological metaphor, those are the natives that we study. Well, how they think about these issues? Economic coloniality, which is Western political economy, from Smith, Ricardo, Marx, etc. Epistemic coloniality, is Western Christian theology, science, and secular science, and secular philosophy, and all the kind of knowledge that Kant analyzed in the context of the faculty and began to unfold from there. But the most important is ontological coloniality, the Western concept of nature and the human. What do I mean by this? The human, with H, human men from Renaissance on. And human men was the standard to classify lesser human. And the concept of races and sexes are complementary concepts to dehumanize. Dehumanize in different ways. Because as, what is the Italian, Federici shows, between when she analyzed the good woman and the bad woman, the witches. So in Europe, they were all kind of white and Christian. The good woman was already under the control of men and was necessary to regeneration of the species. So woman is not a biological concept, woman is a cultural concept. So certain bodies were made women in order to devalue and in relation to human men. That in Europe. But when colonial expansion began, sexes that was fabricated in Europe get entangled with races. So you find people of color, blacks or brown, and it so happened that the Indian or the African in the Americas, the man could be under a white woman. So that kind of changes the configuration of races, but the category of making human lesser has two parallel histories in Europe and in the colonies, the Americas, China, Asia, etc., etc. And what about nature? And this is a big problem now, that kind of ecological crisis and all of that. But it begins there. We have, in Europe and United States, we have problems with racism and racism and sexism, and there is a lot of movement, as you know. But nature is the third leg of the ontological coloniality. Why? Because imagine the magnificent, extraordinary energy of life and living in the planet has been reduced to one noun, nature.
So you invent nature
and you control it, you invent races and you control lesser human, be men or women or color. So we have now the ecological crisis because that was the creation of modernity. Nature became there to be known and exploited by men, human, that was Francis Bacon, and then became natural resources, that was the third world. And now we are talking about human resources. You see? So ontological coloniality is where the colonial wound is infringed. So decoloniality starts from there. You cannot change political economy if the people who do political economy don't change. You cannot change the world, as we know Karl Marx said, if the people who live in the world and want to change the world don't change. So that is the big challenge of decolonial thinking and decolonial doing. So I have been talking for almost 1 hour. And I think that I will save you from the hard part, and I will go very quickly so you have an idea of what we call the colonial matrix of power. The colonial matrix of power is like the unconscious, a monster. Yeah, a monster that controls us and we don't notice that we are controlled. Yeah? Until somebody make us aware and we begin to think about that. Yeah? So the way we analyze the colonial matrix of power is 4 domains, 2 levels, and flows. I don't have time to kind of go in detail, but just go very quickly. The 4 domains are knowledge and understanding, and I refer here to institutional knowledge, because human beings generate knowledge just because are human beings. But all living organisms generate knowledge. If the bees or the ant did not generate knowledge, they cannot be today building beehives and anthill without architects, right? The kind of there is a knowledge that is transmitted generation through this living organism. The same the plant, and you can multiply this. So knowledge and understanding, I mean coloniality of knowledge. Authority. What we call the state, could be the nation state, could be monarchy, democracy, and all this kind of configuration of institutional organization of society. Economy, that many people call capitalist, but economy and capitalist are 2 different things, and we can go into detail about that. But the question is that after the 18th century, and more 19th and 20th century, economy became synonymous with capitalism. We have to uncouple that. Economy comes from the Greek oikos, the kind of extended family, nomos, the kind of order, regulation of the extended family. You don't need capitalism for that. It's just, I mean, human beings have been doing that all the time. And ecology comes from the same word, oikos, logi, discourse on the oikos. So, but that was trying to find the harmony in the kind of the oikonomy and oikology. Now that has been separated and we have the mess we have. So, and then men, human, we already explained, the category of men is a self-serving definition. For people who, and that's what we call patriarchy, what we call masculinity in all order of life. So those are the four domains. How do we find out those four domains? It's because we study the rhetoric of modernity. We study what the discourse of modernity said about itself. So we link and observe and analyze them. So those are the four domains at one level. At the other level, was the level of the enunciation. And this is a more important level because this is where the four domains are controlled, changed, regulated, managed, etc. And we say that that is interiority. Why? Because the colonial matrix of power builds itself as a territorial interiority, right? So you see it now, one manifestation is the nation state. The question of immigration and refugees in Europe and United States is part of the imaginary, one imaginary that's the nation state within the colonial matrix of power. So what is that locus of enunciation, that interiority? Is managed by actors. I mean, not anybody can go there. You have to be trained. You have to belong to a family genealogy, or you have to go to Harvard or Princeton if you want to just aspire to kind of get into that circle. So actors, languages, I already told you, the six European languages, and institutions. So the universities and the museum are the most powerful institution for the generation and control of knowledge. But then we have other institutions. We have the state, we have the IMF, we have the World Bank, we have all these kind of institutions can regulate. And then we have the flow. And the flow means that you cannot understand one single domain or one single level without understanding the connection with all the rest, right? So for us, the expert, which is celebrated today in modernity, is a perfect ignorant because he knows a little bit about a small thing, but doesn't kind of figure out. So the decolonial thinking is going in that direction. Well, okay, the second point I will just elaborate more quickly. So the colonial matrix of power builds itself as interiority at the same time that expel the exteriority. Within kind of common language we call the other. But here has a kind of conceptual formulation. So it creates exteriority, which means that there is no ontological outside. The exteriority is a creation from the inside to build itself as inside, needing the difference. Yeah? So that is a machine to expel. And that machine that expel create colonial wounds because they expel you to. So let's go quickly. What are the knowledge and authority expel the life, the communal life, wisdom and spirituality. That is no. We have to be modern. We have to forget about wisdom, communal. We have to talk about society. We have to talk about religion, not about spirituality. Expel, what did I hear here? Economy and authority, organization of society, state, expel harmony, equilibrium, balance, which were the principle of many non-modern societies, and replace it by democracy. And democracy become a weapon, a violent weapon, to convince people to vote and many other things, and expel harmony, equilibrium, as it. So the decolonial thinking is not looking for democracy, it's looking for a society that lives in harmony and equilibrium and balance. There is much to say about it. So economy and man did something very fascinating, which is converting, working an exchange to live, or living labor, Marx said, into living to work. Making us happy slaves. We have to be aware of that. In the crisis of 2008, and this is, I understand, the anxiety of the people who lost the job. I understand the anxiety. But what really surprised me is that the hope for them was to recover the job, meaning that the hope was to recover their state of slavery. And that is when emerged a kind of generation of the 20, 25, 30 in the United States, when they say, we are not unemployed, we are non-employed, we are not looking for jobs. So they took that opportunity to really liberate themselves and reinvent their life. Okay, I want to kind of close this, but I will say that decolonial thinking and border thinking emerged when the forces of the exteriority began to take over the center. So if you look at this one, so the forces that come from exteriority comes from people dwelling in the border and generating border thinking, meaning that you cannot eliminate the West. The West is in all of us, but we don't have to accept it. And we have, and you have, Georgia, you have a wealth of things in your memories, in your tradition, to kind of re-articulate as border thinking and dismantle or kind of denaturalize the interiority of the colonial Mexico part. Yeah? There is much to say now, but let's go to the conclusion very quickly. How do we explain the crisis today? It's the closing of the 500 years, 1500, 2000. We are not in a Cold War. It's a no, for us, this is not a new Cold War. Why is it not new a Cold War? Because the Cold War, as we said at the beginning, was a fight between two Eurocentric ideologies, liberal capitalism and state communism. We are no longer there. So what emerged in the 2000, more or less, is de-Westernization, right? De-Westernization is no longer communist. I mean, China is not communist. China is capitalist, and proud of it, proud of it. Russia is not communist anymore. Russia is capitalist. Iran is Muslim, Shia, but a capitalist. Venezuela, etc., etc. The BRICS, India. So there are all what we call economic coloniality or capitalism is global now. Why do we have a problem? If we have a common economy, we should be all happy, right? But the problem comes because the colonial matrix of power went to control capitalism. Right? So it's not admissible that China disobeyed the World Bank and the White House. It's not admissible that Chinese figure out how to get capitalism and liberate themselves through capitalism. That is very interesting. Mao couldn't do it. Mao thought still that communism will give him and the Chinese the way out. Deng Xiaoping figured out that the question to do with is appropriate capitalism, but not to follow the dictate of the West. So that is the de-Westernization, right? So de-Westernization disputes the control of the colonial matrix of power. What I show you here was created, transformed, managed during 500 years by Western North Atlantic states. What is happening now is de-westernization and a small state that align with the United States or China. So de-westernization is disputing the control of the colonial military power. That is a very important point to remember. And the second point, that de-westernization is a state-led project responding to westernization, right? The 500-year westernization, and responding also to re-westernization. And what is re-westernization? In 2008, Obama figured out that through Bush and Cheney, United States had been losing prestige in the eyes of the world. And China was growing 10% a year, right? 10%, 11%. So Obama did, I mean, that is not, Obama didn't use the word re-westernization, it's our decolonial analysis, right? What Obama did was an effort to regain the prestige of United States in the world. So to re-westernize, to maintain control by good manners. To a certain extent, good manners, because he and Hillary Clinton invented the kind of invasion of Syria and trying to get Assad out of his place. I mean, regime change. So Obama is not a kind of an ideal. I mean, he did what he had to do, but so did re-westernization. So there are two moments of re-westernization, which is the discourse in Cairo at the beginning of his presidency, where he's trying to kind of make alliance with the Muslims, and Hillary Clinton 2011 discourse in Honolulu, when she said, and then she published an article in Foreign Affairs, the 21st century is the American Pacific century. Get those troops out of Afghanistan and Iraq, concentrate on the Pacific because China is growing. So re-westernization is already a response to Westernization was an offensive game. Re-Westernization is a defensive game. And this is what we have today. We have the dispute for the control of the colonial military power with China, with Russia, with Iran, with North Korea, that is kind of a, and on the other hand, we have, so we have de-Westernization and multipolarity. So the unipolar world order for 500 years is becoming multipolar. What does it mean? That there is not just one entity or the West who take decisions. Decisions now are being disputed mainly between United States, Russia, China, Iran, and the European Union, that they kind of is still waiting to see what the United States said in order to fall. Our hope is that someday the European Union will stand for itself and will create another important leg in this kind of multipolar. And then finally we have decoloniality and pluriversality. So de-westernization, multipolarity, decoloniality, pluriversality. So decoloniality now is no longer a state-led project. Decoloniality is a project of the emerging global political society, us. We don't have much power, let's say, to intervene in the state and intervene in the interstate system. But we have the power to find, to create our own place in the society while this world order that we don't have much power to intervene, come to some kind of outcome. So the linking from the colonial matrix of power, we don't dispute the control with the link. The link from the colonial and the link from the dispute, right? The world cannot be changed if the people that inhabit the world and want to change it do not change. So it's kind of a start from us. Decoloniality is not a state-led project, but the project of the emerging global political society. And decoloniality after the Cold War means something different to decolonization during the Cold War. Why? Because decolonization during the Cold War, one of the goals was to take control of the state or kick the settler home and form their own state. And they did it. And there was a victory, but there was also a misery because the state was already ingrained in the colonial matrix of power. So decoloniality after the Cold War, after Quijano coloniality, becomes the task of the emerging political society that began to understand what is going on, the limits and the possibilities, but the most important thing is changing ourselves and building a different way of life with the back to the state, the back to the credit card, the back to the iPod, or just use it as you need it, but don't be kind of enslaved to the iPod. So this is the task of decoloniality now. And we are in the kind of the conflict between re-Westernization, de-Westernization, and decoloniality. As people here, I believe we don't have much saying. We cannot forget about that. We can protest, we can do a lot of things, but we cannot spend all our life protesting because our effect is important, but is minimal. What is important in our power is to rebuild a different way of life among yourselves. So, thank you very much for your patience.
ჩემი კითხვა მდგომარეობს იმაში, რომ მაგალითად როგორც ჩვენ ვიცით, მსოფლიო სისტემის პერსპექტივაც და დაახლოებით მსგავსი, მაგრამ მსოფლიო სისტემების სკოლა უდგება და უშუალოდ მსოფლიო კაპიტალიზმის განვითარებას დაახლოებით იქიდან რომ იწყება 1500 წელს და შემდეგ მოდის დღემდე, ხო? მაგალითად ჯოვანი არიგი უდგება ისე, რომ ჯორჯ ბუშის მოსვლამდე არსებობდა ეს ჰეგემონია, ამერიკული ჰეგემონია აქამდე არსებობდა და ამერიკულ ჰეგემონიას შეექმნა პრობლემა, ან ის პრობლემა ბევრ რამით იყო გამოწვეული, მაგრამ ერთ-ერთი იყო ის, რომ დაუშვათ ჯორჯ დაბლიუ ბუშმა მოინდომა ახალი ამერიკული საუკუნის შექმნა და ჰეგემონის თავიდანვე დამყარება ამერიკის, რომ ამერიკის ჰეგემონია ყოფილიყო განგრძობადი, ხო? მე მაინტერესებს ამ თეორიისგან, რომელიც ჰეგემონიიდან ამოდის, ძირითადად რითი განსხვავდება, იმიტომ რომ მე როგორც დავინახე, თითქმის დაახლოებით თან მსგავსია. უბრალოდ მე მაინტერესებს ესეც რამე, რომ თქვენი პერსპექტივით, დეკოლონიური პერსპექტივით, ესე რომ ვთქვათ, აქ ხომ არ გადავდივართ აგენტურობას, ხომ არ ეს ხომ არ არის უფრო advanced ან დამატებითი თეორია, რომელიც აგენტურობას ანიჭებს ხალხს ან პოლიტიკურ საზოგადოებას. ანუ ეს მაინტერესებს, რომ აქ შემოდის პოლიტიკურ საზოგადოება, იმიტომ რომ ჩვენ ყოველს მსოფლიო სისტემაში ხედავთ, რომ იქ აგენტურობა გამქრალია. მადლობა.
So two things to start with. Quijano worked with Wallerstein and they even published an article together in 1992, Americanity as a concept. So the difference, and they are not enemies, the difference between Quijano and Wallerstein is that Wallerstein's world system sees the world from above, from the North Atlantic. Quijano sees the world from the receiving end of the world system theory. So I think that this kind of relate to the year point, last point, that coloniality gave a kind of empowerment to the people from the former third war, right? So that is one of the points. The second point, there is a lot of compatibilities between a world system theory or world system analysis and coloniality. And Quijano and I myself would agree that the moment of Bush, the New World Order of Bush father, was the moment in which we find the last chapter of trying to homogenize the world. And that is the neoliberal chapter. Because for us, what is distinguished neoliberalism is not consumerism. Consumerism is capitalism. It's based on consumerism. True that neoliberalists emphasize consumerism, emphasize the free market, but the most important, from the coloniality point of view, the most important thing of neoliberalism is the last attempt to homogenize the world. The first was Christian theology. The second was secular civilizing mission of England and France, progress and civilizing mission. The third was United States development and modernization after World War II. And the last one was neoliberalism that started with Thatcher and Reagan. But for us, again, the question is not just the economy, it's the whole effort to kind of convert the world into a kind of Western mentality. And that was the last chapter also of Westernization. Why? Because it was stopped. Was stopped by China, was stopped by Russia when Russia kind of began to rebuild itself after the collapse of the Soviet Union, began to be stopped by the BRICS, then kind of regenerated, but now it's being stopped by Islam and all the kind of the Muslim corridor from Tehran. So that is the difference with Wallerstein. Because Wallerstein in the 90s, he was imagining after the collapse of the Soviet Union that in the future, Europe will kind of join forces with Russia and China with the United States. From the point of a colonialist, no, you are crazy. That cannot be because of races. Because the European Union would not go with Russia because of the kind of racial difference. And United States will never go with China because of the historical difference. So Wallerstein was just seeing economy. And we are seeing the whole spectrum, the whole cultural spectrum, knowledge, and including races. Because I don't want to offend you if I say what I'm going to say. I say in a kind of a spirit of analysis. the way that Iran, we know since 79, but then Putin and Xi Jinping and the Chinese, they are leaders, they are powerful people, but they know that they have been racialized by the West. They know that the West consider them inferior and expect them to follow the rule. So Wallerstein couldn't see that. But from the perspective of coloniality, it's very clear. It's very clear, and that is where de-Westernization comes into the picture. Because de-Westernization is kind of disobedience at the state and economic level. I don't know if I kind of address some of your points, but very important question.
თქვენ ახსენეთ, როდესაც ბოლო მეოთხე თავზე საუბრობდით თანამედროვეობასთან დაკავშირებით, რომ დღევანდელი სამყარო, ეს იგი ერთგვარი ორ სქემიანი ძალაუფლებრივი ერთის მხრივ და მეორეს მხრივ ეკონომიკური პროცესები მიდის. დღეს ჩვენ უკვე ვცხოვრობთ გლობალურ კაპიტალისტურ წესრიგში. Თუმცა ეს იმას არნიშნავს, რომ ამ გლობალურ კაპიტალისტურ წესრიგთან ერთად კოლონიური ინტერესები და ძალაუფლებისკენ სწრაფვა სხვადასხვა ეპიცენტრების ნელდება, ხო? ამიტომ რომ კვლავ გვაქვს ეს დაპირისპირებები და ექსპანსიის სურვილი, ხო? და ეს რაღაცა სუბორდინაციის მოპოვების, დომინაციის მოპოვების სურვილები. მე ეგეთი კითხვა მაქვს. იმიტომ რომ დღეს კაპიტალისტური სამყარო ესეთი გლობალური არის, ხომ არ შეიძლება იყოს გაგებული არა როგორც მარცხი, არამედ რაღაც ტიპის შესაძლებლობა, იმის გამო, რომ არსებობს ესეთი მყარი ჯაჭვი მთელ სახელმწიფოებს შორის და მთელ მსოფლიოს ირგვლივ დღეს, ამ ჯაჭვის რაღაცნაირად გატეხვა და ამ პროცესის მორხევა, მაგალითად, თუნდაც ისეთი პატარა ქვეყნების მიერ, როგორიც არის საქართველო, ხო არ დაუსვამთ, ანუ ხო არ დაასვამთ კითხვის ნიშნის ქვეშ მთელ ამ გლობალურ წესრიგს, რომელიც ესე მყარად არის ერთმანეთთან დაკავშირებული და კაპიტალიზმის დასრულება, ანუ მეორე იგივე მიბმული კითხვა არის, მოიაზრებს თუ არა თავის თავად ამ კოლონიური წესრიგის დასრულებასაც? ჩემი აზრით არ მოიაზრებს, თუმცა ვისურვებდი, რომ ამაზე უფრო მეტი აქცენტი დაგესვათ. მადლობა.
დიდი მადლობა წინვალე ლექციისათვის, ძალიან დიდი ინფორმაციის მოწოდებისათვის. მე გამიჩნდა კითხვა თვითონ კოლონიზაციის ფორმაზე. ის ფორმები კოლონიზაციის, რომელიც თქვენ აღწერეთ, რომ გავითვალისწინოთ თეორიულ საფუძვლად ავიღოთ, თქვათ, კარლ შმიდტის ზღვის და მიწის იმპერიები, ამ შემთხვევაში დასავლური კოლონიზაცია ეს არის ზღვის კოლონიზაცია, რა, ზღვის სახელმწიფოთა კოლონიზაცია. აღმოსავლეთში და პირველ რიგში გულისხმობდი რუსეთის იმპერიას, ეს არის მიწის იმპერია, მას არ გააჩნია ზღვა, ანუ ფლოტით კოლონიზაცია მისი არ მომხდარა და გამოვიყენებდი კიდევ ალექსანდრ ეტკინდის ტერმინს შინაგანი კოლონიზაცია. ამ ტიპის შინაგანი კოლონიზაციით, რომელიც გულისხმობს საკუთარი იმპერიული სხეულის გაფართოებას, სხვაგვარი დეკოლონიზაცია შეიძლება წარმოვიდგინოთ, არა, სხვა სცენარით, რომელიც ალბათ ყველაზე მეტად ჯერ 1917 წელს რუსეთის იმპერიის დაშლით და შემდგომში ხელახალი აღდგენით საბჭოთა კავშირის სახით, მაგრამ ბოლოს საბჭოთა კავშირის დემონტაჟით, რომელმაც ძალიან სასტიკი რეაქციები, ომები გამოიწვია. რამდენად შესაძლებელი არის აი ესეთი შინაგანად კოლონიზებული მიწის იმპერიის დეკოლონიზაცია, თუ არსებობს გათვალისწინება ამ სპეციფიკის სწორედ დეკოლონიზაციის თეორიის თეორიაში?
The first question was about self-colonization and the second one was about Professor Minolo's involvement in contemporary art, and especially in that term he uses, decolonial aesthetics.
Can a small state, in my view, no. I don't know about Georgia, but I can give you the example of Bolivia. So with Bolivia, we have in 2006, when Evo Morales came into became president, was a lot of enthusiasm in South America because we have the Kirchner in Argentina, we have Rafael Correa in Ecuador, we have Lula da Silva in Brazil, we have Mujica in Uruguay, and we have Chavez. And we said, well, this is the moment of decolonization. Eh? And what happened? Chavez was died. I don't know how he died. Lula da Silva and Dilma Rousseff were kind of taken out with a kind of illegally by a judicial coup. Now there is, they are kind of giving evidence that everything was fabricated, but it doesn't matter. We know that, we knew that was fabricated. Now the documents are confirming that it was fabricated. So what? The right wing that control capital controls. So the question here is that, and you see it now in the United States, who control money control meaning, and who control meaning control money. So within that colonial matrix of power that was fabricated by the people who control meaning and money, today is very difficult for a small state to do anything. So something can be done, kind of in defense of sovereignty and this, but those are kind of a scratch in the colonial matrix of power. The colonial matrix of power now, including the dispute, with the dispute is becoming stronger because technology is kind of developing astronomically because of the dispute. Financial, industrial production, television, all this kind of is multiplying because of the dispute. So a small state now are not really in a position to do anything there except make alliance with whatever you like, Russia or United States or China or Iran. That depends on who is the president at the time, what is the preference of the president, etc. So the second question was, I remember now. No, of course, that's our thesis. That coloniality and what we call capitalism, global economic coloniality and racism are all together. Why racism? Because, and what relation with capitalism? Because racism in the 16th century in the Americas was necessary to justify appropriation and expropriation of land and massive exploitation of labor. To do what? To produce commodities for a global market, because now it's coming. So coloniality, racism, and we call capitalism all together. So the question is to get out of that. How do we get out of that? Well, the coloniality is trying to delink from all that and live in a different way. Because now the dispute for the colonial matrix of power maintains racism, maintain coloniality, and maintain capitalism and exploitation of nature that goes together with racism. So the question of Carl Schmitt, that's very interesting. Madina Trostanova, my colleague and a friend, wrote about Russia as a second-class empire. Because, yes, it was on land and the other was on sea, but the question is that, as I understand it, that since Peter the Great, so Russia trying to do the same, but always have the West as a kind of a guide. So in that sense, Trostanova calls a second-class empire. So Russia, as I said, was never colonized, but coloniality was kind of getting the virus into the people who kind of expanded through Eurasia, the conflict with Turkey, etc., etc. So I think that there is one aspect of your question that is related to your question, that is a question of internal colonialism, if I understand correctly, right? So what happened there, and that was decolonization during the Cold War. So the victory, the splendor of decolonization from India to Algeria, including many other places, was that they managed to send the settler home and build their own nation state. But the nation state was controlled by the elite, the native elite of each country. So that is what constitutes internal colonialism. So the elite of this country, Algeria, India, even South Africa today, the end of apartheid is very important, But at the same time, there is an elite that take control and does exactly the same that the white was doing in South Africa or the British or the French in Algeria. They do exactly the same, but they do it themselves. So that's the kind of internal colonialism. And that happened in South America since the 19th century. We gained independence from Spain and Portugal, and the national elite did exactly the same. And for Indians and Afro, they were in worse condition under the nation than they were under the colonies. So, and the question of, wow, this is another lecture. Can you invite me? I tell you very quickly, what do we mean? Number one.
We have to conclude in 5 minutes.
Number one, aesthetic cannot, there is no aesthetic universal. What Kant and Hegel call aesthetic is modern European aesthetic. But aesthetic is the regulation of taste and regulation and celebration of genius. Then Rancière complicated things, but I mean, it's that kind of tradition. What we are trying to do is that say that aesthetic, modern aesthetic, colonize aesthesis. And aesthesis is sensing, emotioning. And aesthetic control and regulate and tell you what is beautiful, what is sublime. And if you go to a museum and you don't have anything to say about a magnificent painting or a sculpture, you feel bad. And that is coloniality of being, right? So we are trying to delink from that. And artists are doing the same. I mean, artists we are working with. So what artists, the colonial artists that are engaged in the coloniality, they are saying that art for them is a way of healing the colonial wound. Because they are artists that they don't want to be artists like European, etc. They want to use art to heal the colonial wound instead of being a slave and produce art according to the kind of the cosmology of Western. So in that direction we are kind of working. Thank you.